Hello Python programmers, this is AK. In this video, we are going to create one retro classical game using Python. So this is the fifth video on the game development project series in Python. The special thing about the game development projects in our channel is, for each five videos, we are using different libraries to develop games. Now we are strong in all the game development libraries. For example, in the first game development project, we used the free games library. Second one is about the turtle library, and third one is the arcade library, and finally the fourth one is the Eurasia engine. If you haven't watched any projects, then check out all four projects. Definitely you will learn so many new things about the game development. Okay, so in this video we are using a popular game development package in Python that is called Pygame. Seriously guys, making games using Pygame is a very easy one, but the problem that I faced is the game logic. Before getting into this video, I like to share the game development experience and the problems that I faced during this game project. First of all, I am not a professional game developer, but I am slightly interested in the game development field. So in this channel, majorly I uploaded the machine learning contents and Python projects. Occasionally I develop game projects. In this video, this project shows me how it is very hard to develop games using programming. I spent completely 2 days on this project. So the problem that I faced in this project is the collision between the game objects. I successfully created the game objects like paddle, ball. For making the collisions or interaction with the objects, it is a little bit hard for me. Why I am sharing this experience means, compared to machine learning, the game development field is more harder than you think. So this is my experience about this game project, and let's start this project. For creating this game, you need a Pygame library. So first you need to install the Pygame library. So go to your CMD and type pip install pygame. It will take some time to install. Here I already installed it. So this is the only dependency for this project. Okay. Next you need to import some libraries. So import the libraries like pygame, system and random library for making the logics and objects in the game. Now you need to create a class. So create a class called MyGame. Inside this class, we are going to write the entire game code, and it is a primary class. Under this class, we are going to write our main function. So type def main, and inside this pass the parameter self for accessing our variables. Now we are going to determine the speed of the ball that will travel in the x direction and y direction. Create a variable x speed and give the value as 10. So this is for the x axis direction, and for y axis, you need to create y speed variable and give the value as 10. And next one is the lives. Create a variable lives and give any integer value that you want. You need to understand one thing, if we miss the ball, then the lives variable will be decremented. Here I just give the value as 5. Suppose if we miss the ball 5 times, then you are declared as a loser. Now we only created the variable for the lives. When we are going to write the logics, we will use this variable value. After this, we need to create another variable called paddle speed. Here you need to give the integer value as 30. Why we have created this variable means, if we move the paddle in the x direction, we need to increment this value towards the x axis. It's a 2D game, totally we are having only 2 axes. The paddle object only moves in the positive x and negative x direction. It will not move in y direction. The ball object is the only object that able to move in the all directions in the game screen. Okay, so you need to understand this game logic first. Another important one is the points. When the ball hits the paddle, the points variable will be incremented, and it will display your points in your screen, in your game screen. Create variable called points and give the value as 0. So initially the points value will not be incremented. When the ball hits the paddle, the value will be incremented. Okay. The next one is the background color. You can give any color code that you want. Here I just give the background color as black. Now you need to give the geometry of your screen. Create a variable called size. In this variable, you need to give the height and width of your game screen. Okay. Next step is we need to initialize the Pygame engine. Create an instance called pygame.init. When you type the statement, you will allow to use the Pygame syntaxes. When you are not giving these statements, the Pygame syntax will not be considered as a valid statements. So this is why we are using it. After this, we need to create the game objects. The game objects means the elements that we are using in this game. In this game, I am using three major elements that are paddle, ball, and the sound file. In the Pygame library, we can insert any image in our game. For the paddle, I am using this image, and for the ball, I am using the ball image. First, you have to understand one thing. When you are using the image in your game, you need to choose the image with correct sizes. In this game, I choose the 32 pixels image for the ball object and the same thing for the paddle also. I downloaded the image from the flaticon.com. I will give the link in the description so you can check those images on that site. Now we are going to create the paddle object. First you have to create the paddle variable, and the syntax for loading the image is pygame.image.load, and inside this object pass your image name that you want. After that, create one variable called paddle rectangle. So this variable is used to create the rectangle boundary on the paddle object. If you want to move the paddle object to any place in the game screen, you can simply call this variable to move it around the game screen. For creating the rectangular boundary for a game object, you need to call getRectangle method to make a rectangle boundary. Follow the same syntax for loading the ball image and sound files and background image also. So let's move to the next section. So the next section is arranging the variables for the game loop. We already created the rectangle boundary. So in this section, just mention the boundary value for cropping the rectangle shape on the object. We are using rectangle boundary on the two objects on the game screen. They are paddle and ball. Now call those variables here and give the value for the rectangle boundary cropping. You need to understand one thing. We are not actually cropping the pixels. Just this word is relatable to you for understanding this process. Here I just explained what I done in these two variables. Here I moved the rectangle boundary to the values that I inserted in the move parameter. So this is a little bit hard to understand. I tried my best in the explanation. If you want more, I will give the link that is related to this in the description, so you can find more things about this. And create a variable called x speed. Here pass the starting x speed variable and do the same thing for the y speed also. So this too is used to increase or decrease the object speed when it is reacted to its collision. Now create a variable lives, and in this variable you need to call the lives in it. When we are processing the game loop, we can use this variable for increasing and decreasing the speeds and lives also. The next one is the clock variable. In this variable we are going to track the amount of time. And next type pygame.key.setRepeat, and inside this object pass two parameters that are 1 and 30. This object is used to send the timing inputs to the game. So I will give the detailed explanation about this statement. When you enable this feature, you can send multiple number of inputs to the game. In this object we are passing two values. The first value is delay. It will delay the keystrokes, and the second value is the time interval between the two keystrokes. Okay, both are in the unit of the millisecond, so we can easily manage the time between the keystrokes that were given while playing the game. So this is the end of this section. Next we are going to create the game loop. Declare a while loop, and the first thing that we are going to do is the frame rate. In Pygame we can use clock.tick method to increase or decrease the frame rate of our game. Here I give the frame rate as 40, so our game can run in 40 FPS. Second process in the game loop is the events. Generally, if you want to get any events in Pygame, you can use the for loop to get the event. In order to get the event in the for loop, type for event in pygame.event.get. When you declare this statement, you can call multiple events under this loop. If you are a beginner in Pygame, you can ask me a question like, what is an event? The event is basically the user activity in the game. Suppose when you give the input to a game, that is called an event. The first event in the game is the quiet option. So type if event.type that is equal to pygame.quiet, then the game window will be closed. For closing the window, we are using system.exit method. So this is the one way of quieting the game application, Let's add the another event. If you press the escape key, and that operation will also close the game application. So you have to type the same syntax for this operation. So this is our second event. And the third event is used to move the paddle in the left hand side direction. First I type the code and then I will explain the code. Okay. So the first condition is, if the event dot key that is equal to pygame dot key left, this line explains that when the user presses the left arrow key, then the paddle will move to the left hand side. For moving the paddle towards the left hand side, we are inserting the minus sign in the paddle speed. So it will travel in the x negative direction. And again we inserted another condition. This condition explains that if the user moves to the end of the left side screen boundary, then the paddle will not move. So this is the condition that I inserted. So copy this code and paste the code here. You need to remove the minus sign in the paddle speed variable, so it will travel in the right hand side direction also. Okay. Next you need to add another condition. If the paddle touches the right boundary width, then it needs to be stopped. If the paddle wants to stop, type paddle rectangle dot right hand side that is equal to width. So the paddle will pause in the 500 pixel value. So that's our width of the game screen. So this is the logic. You have to understand it completely for creating this game. Okay. Next we are going to create the logic for the collisions. Before that I will give the demonstration of how this logic works. So this is the logic between the paddle and the ball. Before this game loop, we cropped these two objects in the rectangular shape. Generally the rectangle has four sides: top, left, right and bottom. But the ball object is different. It is not able to spin in this game. The possible side of the ball hitting the paddle is bottom, right and left. You can imagine this. Actually the ball here is not able to spin. So the top side of the ball will not collide with the paddle. It actually remains empty. Empty means it will not interact with the paddle. But the paddle is not like that. It will interact four possible sides, even the bottom side also. First I write the code and then I will explain to you. First we are going to check whether the bottom side of the ball pixel is greater than or equal to the top side of the paddle. If this condition gets satisfied, then there will be a possibility of collision. This is the first condition. If the bottom of the ball value is less than or equal to the bottom of the paddle, then it will be a collision. Totally there are four possible collisions for the paddle, and for the ball there are three possible collisions, and the remaining two are the right hand side and left hand side of the ball and the paddle. Okay. And next we need to create the variable for the speed of the ball which travels opposite direction when it interacts with the paddle. So that we are using the minus sign in the y speed variable. If all these conditions get satisfied, then the ball responds in the opposite direction when it is interacted with the paddle, and create another variable called as points. So this is used for if the ball hits the paddle, then this variable will be incremented. So another one is the offset. So create a variable called offset, and in this variable we are going to find the distance between the paddle and the ball. Now we are going to write the logics for the offset. First I write the code and then I will explain to you. Here you can see that I wrote the conditions of the ball hitting the paddle in the right hand side. You have to understand that if we are using the positive values in the logics, then it denotes we are operating the right hand side. If it is negative sign, then we are operating the left hand side. If it is zero, then the object won't move. So this is a simple thing you need to keep in your mind. Here you can see that if the offset value is greater than zero, it means the ball hits the paddle. In this logic, we are applying the angling which the ball travels in the x direction. The nested conditions are, if the offset value is greater than the 30 degree angle, then it will travel in the x speed of 7 value. If the ball hits the paddle in this angle, then its direction will also change. Note that it is for right hand side only. If it is for the left hand side, then you have to change all the positive values to the negative sign. Okay. So here the 30, 23 and 17 are the angles at which the ball travels hits the paddle. Okay, so copy this code and change the positive value to the negative sign. Automatically these conditions will apply for the left hand side of the paddle. So this is the end of this section. Next section is when the ball moves around the screen. It means the ball hits the boundary of the screen. Now call the ball rectangle variable, and in this variable pass the move object and call the respective angling speed it travels. First I will write the code and then I will explain to you. Here the first condition explains that if the left hand side of the ball rectangle object that hits the less amount of 0 pixel value, then it will travel in the opposite direction. In the left hand side, the 0 is the starting point and the right hand side 500 is our ending point. So when the ball hits these two sides, then it will travel in the opposite direction. Okay. Another one condition is if the top portion of the ball hits the top side of the screen, then it will travel negative y direction. And one more thing is if the ball hits anywhere in the screen, then it will play a blip sound. So these are the things that I added in this condition. And next logic is when the player misses the ball will reappear somewhere in the game screen. So this is the exact logic. So let's write the logic for this feature. The first step explains that if the ball will reappear, then it will travel at the start speed. And we created one object from the random module. It is used to display the ball from the random area in the game screen. But we are not yet decided where the ball will reappear. So the reappeared ball will always travel in the starting speed direction of x and y. And then create a variable called ballRectangle.center that is equal to the position of the ball which will appear when we miss the ball. I will explain this statement more clearly. If the player misses the ball, then the ball will respawn somewhere in the center of the game screen. So this is the logic that I inserted in these conditions. Okay. So this is the end of this section. Let's move to the another section. This section is very simple one. You can easily understand this section. So if our lives are exhausted in the game, then it will display a message like game over. So this is the explanation of this condition. You can easily understand these statements. I'm not going to explain about this. If you already watched all the above logics, then it will be easy for you. Okay. The next one is the game restart loop. It is pretty easy one. We already did this initially. So I skipped the explanations here. Finally, you have to update all the things on your screen. The first thing we have to update is the background color. And the second one is the background image. And the third one is the scorecard. And finally, draw all the things on your screen. For drawing every element on your screen, you need to use the blit method in the pygame library. Now we have to update all the things. For updating every elements in this game, you have to use pygame.displayFlip. This method is used to update each and every element on your screen. So that's all about the code. Just call the main class and the function here. So we finished all the things. Let's run this program. So you can see that our code works well. So that's all about this video. If you like my explanations and my content, like this video and then subscribe for more interesting content like this and comment down your queries. If you have any doubts about this project, then ping me on Twitter. I will clarify your doubts at any time. Thanks for watching and thank you. See you on next video.